éxito laboral.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to webinar organized by NITYA Tax on GST annual compliances. Thank you for participation in large number, and we still have many participants logging in. So we'll start our session at 11:05 a.m. Thank you. next. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the webinar organized by NITYA Tax Associates on GST annual compliances. Before we start our session, there is some background why we organize this seminar. GST annual compliances is a very new subject this year, this being the first year of GST. And there are a lot of notions or confusions in the mind of industry as to how to deal with these compliances. Like one such notion is that GST annual compliances is confined only to GST audit. It is not so. GST annual compliances envisages three different activities. One, GST audit. Secondly, filing of an annual return. Thirdly, a reconciliation between your annual return and your audited financial statements. So is this requirement of annual compliances or GST audit new for indirect taxpayers? Yes, it is. Because in July 2017, we shifted over from excise and service tax regime, which was a self-assessment regime. A registered manufacturer was required only to file a monthly return. A service taxpayer was required to file a half yearly return. There was no concept of an audit by an independent auditor. Yes, indeed, in respect of VAT, many of the states have requirements of VAT audit. But again, those audits were also confined to basic matching of sales and purchases as reflected in books of accounts vis-a-vis the VAT returns. So for indirect taxpayers community, yes, this requirement is indeed new. So most of us are limited companies under the Companies Act. So apart from a statutory audit income tax audit under 44AB, we have a new requirement of GST audit. So before this session, I was just reading what is the meaning of an audit. So when I Googled, so the immediate definition came an official inspection of an organization's accounts by an independent body. In Hindi, the definition read, Vartaman Sthiti Ki Adhikarik Janch. So very important to note that one, it's an inspection, and two, inspection is by an independent body. We also need to keep in mind what is the objective because of which the government is insisting for GST audit, GST annual compliances. If you see your journey for last 14-15 months, what have we done? To transit our credits, we filed Tran 1. On every month, we are filing GST R1 and GST R3B. In GST R1, basically you're giving details of customers to whom you have sold the goods. In GST R3B, you're giving an overall abstract of your total GST liability and total GST credits. So as of now, the government really does not know what are the goods, what are the services on which you have taken the credits. They do not know whether in respect of all reverse charge transactions you have discharged the tax. They do not know whether the classification adopted by you is correct or not. So this is the underlying reason for bringing in the concept of GST audit, that they want to put onus on company's management as well as the auditor, who will independently verify whether the company has done all its statutory compliances, whether the company has paid all applicable taxes, company has taken correct input tax credits. And that will be the basis for the GST authorities to undertake audits, assessments, investigations in future. And this being the first year, the GST audit assumes significant importance, because we also during last 15 months have been in a journey to shift over from old laws to new laws and comply with newer requirements, with new set of regulations, notifications coming every day. So GST audit assumes significant importance. Recently, there was a forum as well where Mr. Rehman from the government, he was there. And when the industry chambers were asking them the importance of GST audit, so the government's perspective on GST audit is that if you have done all your compliances properly, then they don't want their officers to interact with you. They don't want their officers to meet you, visit your premises, etc. And GST audit is the basis, or the annual return will be the basis on which they will verify whether your compliances are in order or not. So in respect of GST audit, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India last week and Institute of Cost and Works Accountants of India a couple of weeks back issued their guidance notes. So we have tried to cover a significant part of those guidances as well in our today's presentation. And with this background, we start our presentation. In our presentation, we'll be covering the legal framework of GST annual compliances, the objective, GST annual return, what are the salient features of that, including some pertinent issues to be taken care of, reconciliation statement, the various contents of reconciliation statement, and what are the various challenges in filling the same. And lastly, way forward, what we recommend taxpayers to do. Coming to the legal framework,
Yes, the last date is 31st December 2018. Very important to note is that this date is hard-coded in the law. Unlike the returns of GST R1 or 3B, where the legislature has put specific provisions in which the date of filing of these returns can be extended by the government, as of now, there is no provision under which the due date of doing this annual compliances can be extended. Firstly, we'll discuss the statutory provisions relating to annual return. The relevant section is section 44(1). Every taxpayer needs to file an annual return. Important to note that this requirement is for every taxpayer, irrespective of its turnover. The annual return has to be accompanied with audited annual accounts and a reconciliation statement. So, reconciliation statement we'll be discussing in the subsequent slides. Another important aspect to note is that the provision refers to audited annual accounts. The law nowhere defines annual accounts, but we understand that the annual accounts is synonymous to the financial statements only. But strangely, the law uses annual return has to be accompanied with audited annual accounts, and reconciliation statement should have a reconciliation with audited financial statements. So for reasons best known to the government, they have used two different expressions, but we can proceed on the basis that annual accounts have to be read as financial statements only. The due date is 31st December 2018, and the requirement to file annual return is irrespective of turnover of taxpayer. There are few exemptions. So to these set of taxpayers, the requirement of annual return does not apply. A casual taxable person, an ISD, a non-resident taxable person, or person liable to deduct TDS or TCS. So from a practical perspective, ISD may be a return which is generally applicable to taxpayers. Now coming to the forms. The government has prescribed three forms for filing annual return. For a normal taxpayer, it is GST R9. For composition dealers, it is GST R9A. For e-commerce operators, it is GST R9B. Coming to reconciliation statement, the applicable provisions are Section 35(5), Section 44(2), and Rule 83. So the law provides that every taxpayer whose turnover exceeds 2 crores is required to get his accounts audited. Important to note that the section talks about turnover in a financial year. So if the turnover of a taxpayer in 2016-17 exceeds 2 crore, there is a requirement to get GST audit done for 2017-18. Who can do the audit? A chartered accountant and cost accountant only. Another important aspect is that this provision talks about audit to be conducted. So there is a mandatory requirement for getting the audit done, but surprisingly, nowhere under the GST law, an audit report has to be issued. So except for the annual return or reconciliation statement, and reconciliation statement has a certificate attached to it, there is no audit report which a chartered or cost accountant has to issue. But that does not absolve the company from not getting the GST records audited. Therefore, undertaking of audit is necessary, but there is no formal report which has to be given except for filing of annual return and reconciliation statement. Very importantly, there is a definition of audit as well. GST law defines audit as examination of. So what has to be examined? Records, returns, and documents. So these records documents can be maintained under GST laws as well as other laws. And what is the purpose of this examination? To verify and assess taxpayers' compliance under GST laws. So in nutshell, the purpose of this audit is to ensure that a chartered or cost accountant has to come to the satisfaction that the taxpayer is compliant with GST laws. If the accountant feels other way around, then yes, he needs to take recourse to qualification or giving comments. Yes, these are the areas on which taxpayer is non-compliant. There can be issues like different companies might have taken positions. So say for example, there are two schools of thought regarding cross charges. We have Columbia Asia ruling which said that a head office provides services to a factory and therefore cross charge has to happen. But even a contrary view has to be taken. So firstly, the CA has to be convinced what is the correct legal position in his mind, and based on that, whether the company has done the compliances or not. Similar position issues can be there for various ITC as well. Say for example, repair and maintenance insurance of motor vehicles. Prior to the recent amendment, it was admissible. But again, there were schools of thought, you know, it should not be admissible. So firstly, the CA needs to be convinced as to what is the correct position. And based on that only, he can come to a conclusion whether taxpayer has complied with the law or not. As a part of reconciliation statement, a taxpayer needs to submit audited annual accounts, which we understand audited financial statements only, a reconciliation statement, which will be discussed, which is in form GSTR 9C, duly certified by CA. And the due date we have already discussed, it is 31st December 2018. So this is an example that how PAN-based turnover of a taxpayer has to be determined for considering limit of 2 crores. In our view, since the section talks about turnover of a financial year, therefore complete year's turnover has to be taken, which is April 17 to March 18. So we took an example that if a taxpayer has 3 GSTINs, Delhi, Haryana and Maharashtra, where Delhi and Haryana have nil turnover and Maharashtra have 2.5 crore turnover, then because as a legal entity or at a PAN level, he's crossing 2 crores, he needs to file 3 GSTR 9Cs. Another example can be, there are 3 registrations, Delhi, Haryana and Maharashtra, having turnover of 60, 60 and 70 lakhs, where the total turnover does not exceed 2 crores. In that case, in our view, no GSTR 9C needs to be filed. Now, coming to the objective of all these annual compliances, so initially when this GST audit was talked about, we as a firm, we thought that GST audit is more of a number crunching exercise where one only needs to tally whatever the figures are coming in GST returns with the financial statements. But when we went to the statutory provisions in detail, and when we saw the formats of GSTR 9, 9C, CA certification, etc., we felt that it is not merely a number crunching exercise. It is not just an extension of statutory audit. It is very different from a statutory audit. In our view, GST audit envisages examination of all the positions adopted by the taxpayer, whether it is on output side, whether it is on credit side, all the compliances undertaken by taxpayer. And this holds true irrespective the taxpayer is audited under other laws. The other laws can be Companies Act, it can be Income Tax Act. And the audit definition under GST Act clearly provides that the purpose of audit is to verify correctness of the turnover, taxes paid, refunds, and ITC availed. So GST audit envisaging all those verifications. This requires deep understanding of GST laws, time to time notifications, circulars, FAQs, advanced rulings on the part of auditor to verify all these things properly. Another important aspect to note is that as far as annual return is concerned, this being a return will be filed by the taxpayer only. But the reconciliation statement, that needs to be certified by a CA. And just like any other audit, the GST audit will also be based on taxpayers' representations, which are called as management representations in the audit world. Therefore, for correctness or incorrectness of any part of GST audit, taxpayer and the auditor both will be equally responsible. And as we discussed that GST audit is likely to be the starting point for all the departmental investigations, assessments for a taxpayer. With this, I hand over the session to our partner Poonam. So she will run through the aspects relating to annual return GSTR 9.
Good morning, everyone. We'll in next 20 minutes walk through the annual return GSTR 9. We'll be doing this discussion in three parts. To begin with, we'll understand the theme and scheme of Form 9. We'll also understand the data sources for filing the GSTR 9. And finally, we'll walk through the actual format of GSTR 9 and specifically cover some of the observations and comments that we have with respect to different fields. So to begin with, the whole purpose of GSTR 9 is actually to create a document which is a sum of all the GSTR 1, which is the monthly statement of output supply, and GSTR 3B, which is the summary return that is being currently filed by the taxpayers. So in a sense, all the details are largely to be pulled out from the GSTR 1 and GSTR 3B being filed currently by taxpayers. In this statement, the transactions with respect to GSTR 1, and like I said, and any amendments in GSTR 1, and the amendments made to the transactions filed with respect to GSTR 1 need to be mentioned. As of now, when GSTR 9 is to be filed, no fresh liability or credits can be reported. This form is actually divided into six parts with 19 odd tables, and we'll discuss through the specifics of these tables as well. At a very macro level, the details that are to be captured in GSTR 1 are in overall six parts. To begin with, the output supplies related details, which cover the taxable supplies, exports, exempt supplies, nil rated supplies, the supplies which do not attract GST or advances, all of them need to be pulled out from GSTR 1 and need to be mentioned in the tables given. The second set of information that needs to be punched in is the reverse charge liability, which covers the inward supplies, both from registered as well as unregistered suppliers. The third and an important part of GSTR 9 is the details of ITCs claimed, which include the details of credit received through ISD, the credit taken through Tran 1 and Tran 2, And importantly, this statement also requires a reconciliation between the GSTR 3B ITC claims and the ITC claim reflected in GSTR 2A. There is also a specific requirement for us to disclose ITC reversals and ineligible ITC, which includes ITC reversals on account of exempt inward supplies, reversals that are required to be made on account of delay in reporting of our inward supplies, which is as of now 180 days, and Section 17.5 related reversals. The taxes paid as per returns, including any demands or refunds claim, also need to be mentioned in this GSTR 9. And finally, there is also a requirement to mention HSN-wise summary of outward and inward supplies, along with the quantitative details for that. Now, let's have a quick understanding of how will the information be pulled out to be punched in into GSTR 9. Essentially, that information will come from four sources. One is the transaction-wise details of outward supplies, which are filed on the monthly returns, namely GSTR 1. These fields are essentially covered under tables 4 to 9. And thereafter, we also need to mention details of GSTR 3B, essentially to cover the ITC details. There are some of the fields which are to be auto-populated. And some details actually require some fresh information to be retrieved by the taxpayers from their current records. With this, we would look through the actual format of GSTR 9. Like I said, this form is actually divided into six parts. The first part is basically a general information of the taxpayer's details. Interestingly, this part one is not to be auto-populated. It needs to be populated by the taxpayer himself. The actual tax-related details start from table 4. And that's where the details of outward taxes and taxes paid under reverse charge need to be mentioned. So the bifurcation, as we can see on the slides, or supplies made under B2C transactions, supplies made to registered persons, which is B2B transactions, export supplies, supplies made to SEZs, etc., need to be mentioned in this table. One point to be noted is that this whole table 4 only requires transactions to be reported from in the GSTR 1, which is filed for the period July 2017 to March 2017. One point to be noted here is that this table requires in row I the details of credit notes to be with respect to outward supplies under fields B to E of table 4. Any transactions where financial credit notes have been issued with respect to any supplies need not be mentioned in this field. We also see that under rows K and L, there are disclosures required with respect to supplies and taxes made through amendments, which could be an addition to the tax liability or a reduction in the tax liability. Point to be noted here is that those transactions only where amendments have been made by March 2018 alone will come here and not beyond. The next table actually seeks to capture details of outward supplies where no tax was offered on the turnover by the taxpayer, which includes zero-rated supplies, supplies made to SEZs, supplies made on reverse charge, liable to reverse charge, exempt supplies, nil-rated supplies, and non-GST supplies. Any supplies which we have failed to report in our GSTR 1 cannot be reported here. So specifically, for example, if there is interest income which we have not disclosed in GSTR 1 in our returns up to March 2018, will not come here. Table 6 onwards is the details of ITC to be plotted. Important to note that only the ITC available needs to be mentioned in row 6A, which is already auto-populated. It's important to also take note of rows B and C, which require the details of input inward supplies, which are liable to, which are other than those liable to reverse charge. These inward supplies actually need to be bifurcated into three categories, namely inputs, capital goods, and input services. Such kind of bifurcation of inward supplies has so far not been required by the taxpayers. So this is a new set of information that we need to pull out from our records. Table 7 requires details of ITC reversed and ineligible ITC, which is to be reported during the financial year. So the GSTR 3B details where we have reported any reversals or ineligible ITC, that will get plotted here. Important thing to note is that in row E of this table, there is a mention of section 17.5 related credits. On the previous slide, we saw that the table 6 was only requiring details of actually eligible ITC. And so table 7 is actually a deduction from table 6, which we can see from row J of table 7. So if any details are put here in the current format, it would lead to double deduction of ineligible ITC. In case there is no correction to this anomaly, this row will actually need to be kept blank with a specific intimation to the department. There is also a requirement to mention reversals of any transitional credits under row F and G of table 7. There are some reversals which we have recently seen which need to be done on account of the amendments done in July. Those details will not come in these two rows. Table 8 is again an important one to take note of. This is essentially requiring a reconciliation of ITC with the GSTR 2A of the taxpayer. It is to be noted that row A of table 8 is auto-populated from table 3 and 5 of GSTR 2A. This doesn't include table 4 of GSTR 2A, which is the details of inward reverse charge supplies from registered dealers. Again, under row C, there are details of any changes to ITC claimed on inward supplies which are made for the year 2017-18 during the period April to September 2018 have to be disclosed in this row C. Point to be noted is that this specific row is inconsistent with the requirements of section 16.4. Which only restrict the credit beyond the due date of filing return for the month of September, which by the earliest point in time can only be October 20th and not earlier. So in a way, there is an inconsistency between the provisions of section 16.4 and the details which are to be mentioned under row 8C. If we see row K of table 8, we note that C is a deductible item from the total ITC claim, and therefore anything else that is over and above will actually get lapsed. Again, the row D of table 8, it's possible that the total ITC claimed, which is as reflected in PSTR 2A, is for some reason reflecting a lower credit than the actual credit claims in our GSTR 3B. This difference, if it is in negative, is likely to be looked at closely by the tax department during audits. Another thing to note is that column G, which requires details of IGST paid on import of goods, and the column row H, which is IGST availed on import of goods, the difference of these two is also having an impact of getting lapsed. So there remains a possibility that in case for any reason IGST has been paid on any import by 31st of March, but that has not been booked in the books. If the details are to be plotted in the way that are required as of now under Table 8, that difference as per Table 8 will get lapsed. Part 5 of GSTR 9 is essentially any amendments that are disclosed in the output taxes and input tax credit claims for the financial year 17-18, but during the period April to September 18. So any kind of additions to the output liability, any deduction to the output liability, similarly, any reversals which are additionally to be reported, or any additional IDC claims, all of that needs to be captured in this table. Table 15 actually requires details of any demands and refunds. So if there are any demands that have been paid by a taxpayer during the financial year 17-18, and if there are any refunds claimed, those will come in this table. Table 16 requires three types of details. Interestingly, it requires a mix of inward as well as outward details. 16A requires details of inward supplies received from composition dealers. GSTR 1 format as of now actually requires these details, so this is not a rocket science to actually pull these details. It can be easily filled in. But rows B and C are interesting to note. Row B actually requires details of any supplies, any deliveries which have been made to a job worker, but have been under a delivery challan, but if they do not come back within the prescribed time limit under section 143, and hence are treated as deemed supplies. Now from this format, it is not clear whether in this table only the returns which happen, which breach the time limit by March 2018 need to be covered, or will it also require details to be mentioned beyond March 2018. The reason it becomes important for us to understand is that technically the time limit, which is 1 year in case of inputs and 3 years in case of capital goods, will not be breached in any case if only the details up to March 2018 are to be mentioned here. Similarly, row 16C requires details of sales on approval basis which do not materialize within 180 days. Now this is a new requirement which is as of now not reported under GSTR1, and therefore it has to be separately pulled out. Finally, table 17 and 18 require an HSN by summary of outward supplies and inward supplies. While on the outward supplies it's not going to be difficult, but inward supply details could be a little challenging because HSN requires requirement details for inward supplies along with quantity are as of now not required to be reported anywhere by the taxpayers. Okay. So with this, I hand over back the mic to Puneet, who will share his thoughts on GST Aadhaar.
Thank you very much, Poonam, for giving detailed insights on the form. There are a few points I want to emphasize, though Poonam covered that. One very important point to note is that GST R9 is a summary of all the returns. As Poonam highlighted, no fresh details can be put in this. So if any taxpayer has missed any credits, if the taxpayer has failed to discharge liability, those details cannot be captured additionally in GST R9. Second point I wish to highlight is from an ITC perspective is that if you saw the format, the government is asking you to make a complete reconciliation of your ITCs vis-a-vis 2A as well as 3B. So many of you might have done 2A reconciliation, some of you might not have done, but now there is a dire need that these reconciliations have to be done. So all the figures which are coming in 2A, in 3B, in books of accounts, all these three need to stack up fully. Another column which you have noted is in table 8K. This is the first time where there is an auto-populated figure of ITC to be lapsed. The law nowhere provides that the situation in which ITC will lapse, but the government has designed the format in such a way that you will do various number crunching, filling, etc., and a figure will automatically be generated, which will be lapsed ITC credit. Last and very important point is the verification. As I mentioned initially that GST R9 being an annual return, this has to be filed by the taxpayer only. So at the end of the return, there's a column which says, I verify that the particulars are true and correct. I also undertake that I will pass on the benefit in case of reduction in liability. So indirectly, there is an anti-profiteering declaration which taxpayers will be giving in GST R9 as well, that hypothetically, if their tax liability reduces, then they are undertaking to pass on the benefit to their customers. With this, I hand over the session to our partner Kulraj, who will run through the intricacies of reconciliation statement GST R9C.
Good morning, everyone. It has been discussed by our two speakers about the relevance of this entire exercise. In our considered view, reconciliation statement in Form 9C forms the center of this all audit thing. More so importantly, because GST annual return and annual return filed under the erstwhile VAT regime, there were similarities because these annual returns were typically like a consolidation of all the data that have been shared by a taxpayer wide various returns filed throughout the year. GST is completely a new genre for the taxpayer. It brings out a separate form of reconciliation which was never there earlier. Under the erstwhile regime, there used to be reconciliations that used to be done by the taxpayer at the time of audits or assessments, but typically there was no specified format to carry out such reconciliation exercises. So therefore, reconciliation forms the heart of the entire GST audit thing. More so, the reconciliation statement needs to be certified by the CA. So therefore, it also the more gets important that the taxpayer furnishes the right information in GST R9 so that can be reconciled properly with the financial statements. So therefore, to form a part of this GST R9C. the form typically giving a bird's eye view of the reconciliation statement. It's typically a reconciliation between the audited financial statements with the details furnished by NSSC in GST R9. With each of the reconciliation that needs to be carried out in this form, you need to put a reason for the difference, if any. Lastly, the auditor needs to also give its recommendations towards any additional liability that does accrue because of the non-reconciliation. The form typically is divided into five different parts, requiring five different reconciliations to be carried out. Lastly, and most importantly, with all the reconciliations done, a chartered accountant needs to give a certificate of his recommendation or suggestion over the details that are furnished in the form 9C. So typically the reconciliations that are needed to be done in form 9C are towards the gross turnover, which is typically with the financial statements, the taxable turnover, the rate wise tax liability and tax paid, net input tax credit at a gross level, and expense wise input tax credit. So in this entire form, out of these five reconciliations, two reconciliations are something which a taxpayer usually do in terms of the turnover as well as the taxable turnover. However, the later part of three different reconciliations form a completely new genre which has not been taken up at any point of time earlier, which is the rate-wise reconciliation, a reconciliation of input tax credit, and a reconciliation of expense-wise input tax credit. So we'll take you to each of these reconciliations in the next few slides. So firstly, about the reconciliation of gross turnover. So the form requires a taxpayer to arrive from the turnover that has been reported in the annual financial statements and to arrive at the turnover as reported in the GST R9. What is more important is that the annual financial statements of a company having multiple GSTN would be one, wherever there would be multiple GST R9 that would be furnished. So therefore, there will be a reconciliation that needs to be done for each of those GSTN. So the turnover that are reported in financials needs to be first broken up between each GSTN, and therefore you need to arrive at the turnover that has been declared in GST R9. There are the financial adjustments that are normally needed to be done while arriving from the financial statements turnover to GST R9 turnover. This typically is like a cash flow statement that we need to prepare to arrive from one figure to another. Salient characteristics of the reconciliation needs to be done is that the turnover that is coming in the financial statements is the entire turnover of the SSE, including all revenue from operations, including supply of goods as well as services, any interest income, any dividend or indirect income, or even any miscellaneous income that has been there, because it's the reconciliation is being required at a gross level. A segregation needs to be done by the SSE himself between various GSTN, and then with each GSTN, a financial adjustment needs to be parked down to arrive at the turnover declared in GST R9. There are columns wherein you can put the differences which has not been mentioned above. So if there are differences which have not been accounted in above detail, like because of a stock transfer transactions, because of transactions occurred between April to June 2017, which was a pre-GST regime, or financial adjustment, then you can put in column O, which is the regulatory column. If you are unable to identify any of the reasons for reconciliation, then there is a separate unreconciled column where you can put your reasons for the unreconciliation. So therefore, the entire form draws you to get to a figure from the financial statements to GST R9 with you identifying the various reasons to be enabled to get into the details of GST R9. With the gross turnover being reconciled, the form also requires a reconciliation of the taxable turnover. So typically, again, in a typical form of cash flow statement, you get from annual turnover, which is reported in the last column, and get to the GST R9 taxable turnover. The important feature about this form is it needs to identify whether there is an unreconciled taxable turnover, whether you have any turnover which has escaped tax, or you have paid tax in additional, if any. So therefore, the form requires that SAC's turnover, which has been mentioned in the financial statement, which has been subject to GST, is the turnover on which tax has actually been paid by the SAC. Importantly, with the details of gross turnover, we need to have certain deductions, typically of value of exempt supplies, nil rated supplies, non-GST supplies. This also requires to report transactions which are no supply. These are typically a sale of land, actionable claim transactions. Then you need to deduct supplies of zero rated supplies of export of goods or services, transactions on which the recipient is liable to pay GST, on which the supplier has not paid GST, has to be reported in column D, and therefore you need to arrive at the turnover which is reflected in GST and 9. Post you've done that, we need to identify the unreconciled taxable turnover. There could possibly be several reasons for an unreconciliation, majorly if that there's been a short reporting of data in GST and 9, or if there have been incorrect disclosures in the returns that have been furnished in form 3B GST R1 and particulating that to GST R9. So therefore, it is an important segment of this entire reconciliation where you arrive at a difference of any taxable turnover which has been reported in the returns vis-a-vis the taxable turnover that is coming in the financial statements. Post you have done that, the form requires you to reconcile your rate-wise GST liability and GST is actually paid. This again is a very typical thing which has not been there under any of the VAT regime or service tax regime till date, where you reconcile your tax-wise liability both under forward charge and reverse charge and prove that this has been paid under various returns that you have been filed till date. If you have made any adjustment of any tax paid in financial year 18-19 for financial year 17-18, those adjustments can be parked here. Overall, we need to give differences why, if we are unable to identify the reasons between the two reconciliations, then we need to identify the reasons why the reconciliations have not been there. What is most important that is coming out from this form is that, let's suppose there is a situation where the chartered accountant or the cost accountant is of the view that the tax rate applied on a particular supply is different from a tax rate which the SAC has used. So typically, let's say a situation of a taxpayer has used 12%, but the auditor is of the view that such supply shall attract 18%. Those differences shall also get reflected here, and those differences shall be put in the unreconciled payment of the amount, because mind you, this is a form which needs to be certified by the auditor. So auditor needs to be ensure of the tax positions mentioned therein. So if auditor of the belief that a tax rate is higher than what the tax rate has been applied by the SAC, then those details shall come in the unreconciled details herein in the form. Once we reconcile the rate-wise details, the form requires us to reconcile the net input tax credit. Typically, net input tax credit is the tax credit which is appearing in the financial statements taken in the books of accounts. Net of all adjustments, net of reversals, net of debit and credit note, to arrive at the input tax credit which is claimed in the GST R9. So therefore, all the financial adjustments of any ITC booked in earlier financial year but claimed in this financial year, typically a transition credit situation, or an ITC which is booked in the current financial year but claimed in subsequent financial year, have to be parked. Column C typically in this are this detail like you have booked your expense but the credit has been taken in the next year, possibly the credit would have been missed in filing of return for 17-18. Those all details need to be reflected, adjustments need to be parked here, and of course we need to arrive at a difference where whether we have taken an excess credit in GST R9 or a less credit that we are entitled to in GST R9. Again, the objective of government is to ensure that whatever credit you should take should be reconciled with the financial statement that you have prepared and certified by the statutory auditor. Once the net level of input tax credit reconciliation is done, the form requires us a very typical situation as to reconcile the expense-wise details as they are in the financial statement. This is a very typical of situation, not really heard of, because the financial statements are prepared, consolidated. So let's say you have more a number of GSTN, so you firstly need to consolidate every detail, then deconsolidate it to various segments in the GSTN wise, and then identify each expense of that GSTN, and then match the credit that has been taken by the GSTN with the tails in financial statements to arrive whether the credit that has been taken in that very GSTN is the credit that has been reflected in GSTN9. So there is a lot of effort that shall go into preparation of this specific reconciliation of expense-wise details. Notable that the form specifies certain number of expenses. Those are only an exhaustive list. Those are not exhaustive. You can have any other expense that are there in the books of accounts in column P and Q mentioned herein. This is not typically an expense also. Any credit availed in capital goods also require the disclosure here. Anything which again forms unreconciled needs to be reported in column 10. So this again has an objective into ensuring that expense wise you have claimed excess or a lower input tax credit. So therefore, again, a typical reconciliation thing. Once all the reconciliation have been done, the form requires the auditor to give his recommendation over any additional liability that accrues to the taxpayer. This could be on account of any tax that has not been paid at various rates, because of input tax credit that has been excess availed, because of erroneous refund that has been taken. So therefore, this is importantly, the auditor shall give his recommendation. It is not binding on the taxpayer normally, like it's an audit. So auditor gives the recommendation and it is on the taxpayer to follow it up or not. What is more important to follow it up here is that all the payment that happens through the recommendation shall happen only through cash, and no adjustment is permitted to be done through input tax credits here. Once the entire form is done, auditor's recommendation is done, the auditor would need to certify the form GSTR9C. Once he does that, there has to be a certificate that needs to be given by the auditor. The certificate again can be of two different kinds. One by an auditor who does the statutory audit and does perform the GST reconciliation as well. And typically other situation where the statutory auditor and the auditor appointed by the company for performing GST reconciliation is different. We have captured it in the form that where the statutory auditor and the auditor performing reconciliation are separate. Two important things that needs to be covered here is that the auditor need to comment upon the fact whether all the documents and records have been correctly maintained or not been maintained by the SSE. More importantly, auditor also needs to comment upon truth and fairness and correctness of the details mentioned in GSTR9C and whether they have any observations or any qualification in regard to the details mentioned in 9C. So therefore, the certification marks a major onus on the auditors to ensure that all the details that have been mentioned in GSTR9C, which again gets perpetuated by the GSTR9, are correct and true. So therefore, as mentioned initially by Puneet, that the audit is not just a number crunching exercise, it's an exercise of identification of right tax positions as well, which get further strengthened by the fact that truth and correctness of detail mentioned in 9C needs to come in this very certificate. With this, I'll hand over the mic to Puneet to take the discussion forward.
So coming to the last part of the session, and then we'll take up the Q&A. What is the way forward we suggest to all the companies? Being a first year of GST and all these annual compliances, please take note that this undertaking annual compliances will be a time-consuming exercise. So we know that right now the government having extended the date to October 25th, we must be busy in 3B and taking all those credits. Then income tax audit date is also there. But just keep in mind that even GST audit and reconciliations will take significant time at your end. So as a next step, some pre-work which the companies can do is the collation and sanitization of data. Like in the earlier sessions, we were discussing that there are situations where the differences between GSTR 1 and 3B, their reconciliations can start. We have the entire format available. So when the HSN-wise summary of inputs, input services or capital goods is needed, so the work on that can start. Breaking of the expenses into various GSTNs, collating the ITC data relating to that, that work can start. So there's a lot of data collation work which can be undertaken immediately. This we discussed that reconciliation between GSTR 1 and 3B can be carried out. Yes, you'll be needing an expert auditor for doing this. So if you have not yet engaged an auditor, engage them. And once the engagement starts, then the validation of tax positions, compliances, and reconciliation statement has to be undertaken. So these are the recommendations from our side. And the last point which we want to discuss is that what is the last date for taking credits for financial year 2017-18? So is it October 25th or is it some other date? So the GST law section 16.4 of the CGST Act determines by when the credit on procurements for a financial year can be taken. The law provides that the last date for taking credit is the date of filing return under section 39 for the month of September or date of filing annual return, whichever is earlier. Important to note that if we carefully read section 39, section 39 only envisages filing of GST or 3 return. So if we go back to the introduction of GST, the government planned 3 returns, GST are 1, 2 and 3, 1 to be of output, 2 to be of input, which was to be matched with output, and 3 to be the final return. GST are 3 as well as GST are 2, the government did not make it effective because of the IT issues. So as of now, the taxpayers are filing only GST are 1 and GST are 3B. So under section 39, GST are 3 being the return and that being deferred by the government indefinitely. So in our view, section 16.4 requirement should be read as date of filing of annual return only. So which takes us to the date of 31st December only. So while you can make all your efforts to take the credits by October 25th, as assured by the government, but in our view, legally, even if some credits are missed, you can still take those credits by 31st December 2018. Important to highlight that GST 3B is not a return under Section 39. With this, we come to the end of the session and we'll take some of the questions which we have received. The first question which we are taking up is from Mr. Rajendra Kumar. The question which he has raised is that suppose any entries left in 3B or GST are 1, whether it can be included in GST are 9 and what will be the implications of that transaction. So as we discussed that GST are 9 is supposed to be a summary of GST are 1 and 3B already filed by you. You cannot take any fresh credits, you cannot disclose any fresh liability through these annual returns. The next question is why there is a distinction between capital goods, inputs and input services to be disclosed in these returns? Actually, we don't have an answer, nor there is a logic, because GST law treats all goods and services at same footing for entitlement of credit. We don't understand why there was a requirement to break up the credits into these categories. Then we have a question from Mr. Dravid Chhabra. He has two questions. What will happen in case state-wise financials are not prepared? Please note that GST law is not asking you to prepare state-wise financials. The second question is, how will financials be reconciled with GSTR returns, audits, etc.? So the notes to GST returns clearly clarify that your audited financial statements will be the starting point. You need to break up the figures, into various GST registrations and then carry out the reconciliation. Again, the government is not asking you to prepare state-wise financials. The next question is, do I need to report corrections done in GSTR 3B of September? So, as far as the transactions which you have undertaken in GSTR 3B, if they relate to like debit notes or credit notes, ITC for 17-18, there are specific columns in GSTR 9 and 9C where these have to be declared. The next question is from Mr. Sunil Maheshwari. Do we need to report advances of goods post October when tax on same was not payable? So the answer is no. If I understand that you might be supplier of goods on which tax is not there on advances, so those need not be declared. The next question is, do we need to furnish details like non-supply, gifts, free samples, then schedule 3 transactions? The answer is yes. So GSTR 9, 9C, they have specific columns for declaration of that. The next question is, if vendors are correcting data in September GSTR 1, how will they show in GSTR 2A? So in our view, you need to adopt a cutoff date and take that as a basis for filing GSTR 9. Otherwise, if vendors keep on infinitely amending the details, then you'll always be just reconciling these figures. The next question is from Shraddha Churaria. Do I need to take any action if GSTR 2A contains details not related to me? So the answer is no. But yes, these need to be disclosed separately in the forms. There is a column for this. The next question is, what happens if my sales in GSTR 1 and GSTR 3B do not match? So as we discussed that you need to undertake reconciliation between GSTR 1 and 3B. And on an overall basis, these figures need to stack up with the audited financial statements. The next question is from Mr. Mukesh Arora. What are the implications of GSTR 2A versus ITC difference? So the answer is that because these forms are asking reconciliation between 2A, 3B and your books of accounts, you need to reconcile. You cannot keep these differences open. So if the credits are not relatable to you, you don't take those credits. If those are not eligible, those have to be disclosed separately. Otherwise, there's a specific column which I highlighted also, those credits should lapse. So the next question is, Mr. Rohit Mittal, how do we break expense-wise ITC? So I don't know the answer, but yes, these have to be broken up. And being the first year, if some expenses are common, some reasonable basis of apportionment, etc., can be taken. The next question is from Mr. R.K. Maheshwari. Any revision of GSTR 9, 9C permissible? Answer is no. So you need to be careful in filing these returns. The next question again by Mr. R.K. Maheshwari is, how adjustments in September 2018 GSTR 1, 3B be adjusted in financials? So if you have taken credits in the subsequent year, I think these need to be booked as miscellaneous income only. And the last question we have is from Mr. Rajiv. What will be the impact if a taxpayer cannot reconcile 3B ITC with financials? So the answer is, this is not possible. You need to do these reconciliations. So with this, we come to the end of the session. And we again sincerely thank you for joining in such large number. And thank you very much again.